What's up, Philly? Y'all, it is Saturday in the big city. I said, what's up, Philly? I used to go to shows at Trocadero not too long ago right down the street, so I'm just telling you, I want to hear a little bit of energy and excitement, because that's whenever I come to Philadelphia, I got a lot of rowdy people in front of me. So one more time, how are you doing, Philadelphia? Much better. My name is Danica Rome, and I am proud to represent the people of the 13th District of the Virginia House of Delegates, the people of the city of Manassas Park, and the Prince William County portions of Haymarket, Gainesville, and my lifelong home of Manassas. And we've got a great panel up here today about women who have done something that we were told we're not supposed to do, which is to take on the establishment, which is to take on entrenched incumbents, to take on seats that we're not supposed to have for people who look like us, who identify as us, who live like us, who come from the backgrounds that we do. And we won. And we won. And that, the message that we're gonna get across today is basically, what can you do to win? You know, when I was a teenager, I loved watching a documentary, Behind the Music, on Metallica, my favorite band. And any metalheads in the house? All right, I see you. And one of the lines that James Hetfield, their lead guitar, or well, not lead, rhythm guitarist and vocalist frontman said was, we're just four lucky fans who got together and started playing. This could be you. And now I'm up here thinking, you know what? We're just four hardworking, lucky Americans who decided that it was time to start winning. This could be you. And everything that we say up here today, think about that in the context that this could be you. There is nothing that we have done that you are incapable of. And at the same time, we've done something extraordinary because we believed we could and other people believed we could. Do not ever accept defeatism and nihilism as an acceptable way for our America to function and to be told that you can't do this because of who you are. You can't do it because so-and-so is too powerful, so-and-so is too entrenched, so-and-so is doing whatever. The only reason we all won is because our names were on the ballot. Think about that for a second. We were on the ballot and we won. Get on the ballot. And if you're not going to get on the ballot, go help someone else who shares your values to get on the ballot and then work to win. So allow me to introduce the fine people up here today, starting with Rebecca Reinhardt, controller for the City of Philadelphia. Rebecca was sworn in as Philadelphia's city controller, the first woman ever elected to the position in January 2018. Her first time holding elected office, Controller Reinhardt brings private sector experience and nearly a decade of government service to the role of chief auditor and financial watchdog for the City of Philadelphia, and she unseated a 12-year incumbent who had been a state rep before that. Welcome.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Helen Tai. Prior to winning the May 15th special election, Helen served on the Solbury Township Board of Supervisors for 4.5 years. On top of being a master gardener, Representative Tai is a fourth degree black belt in the martial art of Aikido and can fight the good fight on the floor of the house or anywhere else you might find her. And she won a seat that had been held by the Republicans for more than 3 decades. And she's on the ballot again this fall, y'all, in Bucks County. So if y'all are local, go knock doors, go make phone calls, go donate, go win. And last, soon to be State Representative Summer Lee out of Pittsburgh. How you doing? All right, Summer Lee is the incoming representative for Pennsylvania's 34th District. A graduate of Woodland Hills High School and Howard University School of Law. What's up, DC? She defeated a 24-year incumbent with 68% of the vote. And she did it DIY style, y'all, you know? And as for yours truly, my race, I won a 4-way Democratic primary, took on a 26-year incumbent who had been in office since I was in second grade. and we won by 8 points when I was told there's no way a transgender person can win this race. There's no way a metalhead can win this race. There's no way a journalist can win this race. Do you know how much people hate the media? That was gonna be like my top negative, right? It's not your trans, it's not the metal stuff, it's your reporter. Yeah, it was a good one too. And when I hear you can't do this, I just think of what my friend Delegate Jennifer Carroll Foy out of Prince William County, awesome at home, what she had to say. This is a woman who is one of the first black women to ever graduate from VMI, who campaigned while pregnant with twins. They were preemies on top of that, won her primary by 10 votes or 11 votes, and then flipped the seat. And you know what she said? Her whole life has been that obstacle of people telling her she can't succeed. And yet, she said, watch me. And that's what we're gonna talk about today, is the watch me idea. So let me just start with that first part. All of us get asked when we run for office, why are you running for office? What are you gonna do? Give me the flip side of the coin. Tell me about someone who each of you have experienced, or a group of people, or whatever, the naysayers who told you no, who told you you couldn't do it, or you couldn't win, or this wasn't yours to do, X, Y, and Z, and how did you overcome that? So let's start with you, Summer.
Honestly, the most peculiar group of folk who told me that I couldn't do it were people who look just like me, like black women, because we have been told and we have been shown so often that anytime we go up and do something that we've been like beaten down. And a lot of that comes from, I think, self-preservation, but some of it is jealousy, because you know we've been told that we have to do it a certain way, that we have to always hit every, you know, check every box, and before we can step up. And so many people have wanted to do something like me in my town, and have never had the opportunity. So to see it happen, to see me do it the way I did, where I just said, I'm not waiting my turn. I don't care how anybody else had done it before. The time is now. They were like, what? So it was a weird group, but we won them in the end, and they definitely got on and they helped us in the end, but ooh, it was work.
What do you say, Al?
I actually am very fortunate because my supporters believed in me more than I did. I thought there was a chance that I could do it. I'm a statistician by training. I looked at the numbers and I thought, this is gonna be hard, but I think I might be able to do it. And I had just wonderful supporters. Number one was my husband cheering me on. So I feel very fortunate that people believed in me so much.
Okay. So in terms of the naysayers, basically the whole Philadelphia establishment told me I couldn't win.
And not to try
because I was going up against someone that was so firmly entrenched in the city Democratic Party. But I felt that there needed to be change and that the people of the city want change. And I heard going to community meeting after community meeting of, wow, your message resonates and I'm so glad you're running for office. So I think all of that positive energy was actually what carried me through.
And so what we all have in common here is that when we're running for state rep, like the three of us, you know, when you're running for city controller, is you have to know your district. You can't just run a national platform at the local level. You can't hate Trump your way into office. It's like, can you disagree with him all the time? Absolutely, of course you can. Can you privately feel the worst? Yes, you can do that. But that's not what someone needs to hear at the door for your position. What you need to do at your position is explain how you're gonna improve that person's quality of life. I want each of y'all to tell me about your district and what those hyper-local issues are or were that you've carried, that you instinctively tuned in on that your predecessor did not, and that or something that you just knew about your community that you worked hard to make sure that other people understood that you knew and that you could fix.
So I knew a couple things. I knew that people in my district, specifically parts of my district that I'm actually from, the area that I'm from, I knew that we didn't interact with politics the way that some folk would like us to. I knew that politics didn't interact with us. So that was an advantage that we had. We went and talked to people who had never had a politician, a candidate, a party, knock on their door and say, you are, I want your vote, I wanna work for it, I wanna know what you care about. As for our hyper-localized, we have a pretty diverse district. You know, we have black and we have white, we have rural, we have suburban, we have urban, city and different areas. We went and talked about the same thing on every door. We talked about education, that everybody has a right to a quality education. We said everybody deserves healthcare, everybody deserves a living wage, and you deserve to be able to breathe the air, you know, clean air in our district because we have environmental hazards. And people told us that we'd have to change that, that that wouldn't resonate everywhere, and we proved them wrong and we brought people out, but everybody cared about those basic things. I believe you can take those anywhere, and we showed them how you can do that.
Well, in my case, the incumbent had resigned, and he had been in office for 15 years, and I think he became somewhat complacent because a lot of people, when I knocked on their doors, when I said I was running for state rep, people didn't even know who their state rep had been, even though he had been there for 15 years. They didn't even know what a state rep did. So it was a bit, it was interesting just having these conversations, but I think a big part of running for office, people always think you have to tell people what your message is, which is true, but it's also about listening and understanding what's important to them. And oftentimes you can just say, hey, I'm running for office and I'm here to ask you what's important to you. And that goes a long way. And I had so many people say, no one's ever knocked on my door before, or no one's ever asked me what I think. And that helped me better understand what was important to them, so I could make sure that my messaging was clear on what mattered to me in the context that mattered to them.
What was the common feedback you got?
There were a lot of people were very frustrated by Trump, and those were the easy ones to convince, so I didn't have to spend a lot of time with them. But property taxes is one of the things that was very common. Didn't matter if you're Republican or Democrat, a lot of people are frustrated by how much property taxes are. And I was able to talk to them about how a very large percentage of your property taxes are school taxes, and the reason school taxes are so high is because state funding has been cut $1 billion by the Corbett administration, and it used to fund 50% of public education, and now it's more like 30%. So people understood that, you know, the state government wasn't working for them.
Thank you.
I think something that I did that my predecessor didn't do much of was actually go out to the community. And my office is citywide across Philadelphia, so it's going from Northeast Philly to Northwest to Southwest. It's a big city, obviously. And explain what exactly a controller does. And most people don't know. It's the financial watchdog position. And what I did across the city was to listen to people and to understand that people were frustrated by the government, city government, not working the way it should work. And that was my message. My message was, we can save millions of dollars by running the city better. And that money can be put towards services. It can be put towards schools and roads. And we need to do better.
Nice. All right, and so what you heard out of every person who just spoke was that idea of engaging the voter. Nothing beats a quality conversation at the door. Let me go into my editor's voice, write this down. Nothing beats a quality conversation at the door. I was outraised in my primary by tens of thousands of dollars by two different candidates, and we still won by 11.5 points. And in the general election, we knocked more than 75,000 doors in a district that has about 53,000 total actual doors. So we were going out over and over and over again until we had the conversations with the people who we wanted to talk to. And that included up to 6 times that we were knocking on the same door. So let me all ask you about your field program. We could talk about raising money all day and stuff like that, and maybe we'll have a minute for it. But tell me about what was the most important part for you putting together that field program, the data that you used, how important data was, statisticians should help on this, and at the same time, how you use data to effectively target the right doors, to speak to the right voters, and then to bring them out for Get Out the Vote.
So I think one of the most important things that we did on our campaign is that we ran a really robust, like, volunteer operation. We had over 450 individual volunteers who had contact with our campaign, who knocked the door, wrote a postcard, made a phone call, and that really was a difference that people had never experienced. When we went to look at the doors that we wanted to knock and the information that those folk brought back, we trained them hard on what to talk about, how to talk to people, how to really pull information and give information to folk that we were able to then use and say, we may need to go back and engage that person more. When we chose the doors that we wanted to knock on, we looked at those super voter lists that all of your candidates in the state house race ran, and those were voters that, they're great, they're gonna come out and vote, we hit them absolutely. But we also wanted to look at those expanded lists of folks, you know, why haven't you voted since Barack Obama? Why haven't you voted since the general election? And we wanted to talk to those people, and we wanted to meet them where they were, at their community centers, at their houses, wherever we can find them, we wanted to do that. But we were able to keep that data to figure out, you know, how many people we expected to come out and vote, to come up with our win number.
So we also had a very robust volunteer program, and one of the benefits of Trump is that so many people wanted to help out, not only from my own community, but we had groups coming from Philly, we had groups coming from, there was a group from Baltimore who came twice during the special election. They're knocking doors again for me for the general election. So that was a huge help. But basically what we did was, my district is 10 points more Republican than Democrats. We know we have to knock Republican and independent doors or we can't win. And at the beginning we were knocking mostly Democrat doors, and it felt really good. You know, you knock on the door and people are like, oh, we love you, and people would hug me. I mean, it was the weirdest experience of my life. The first night that I knocked on doors was in February, and a woman actually wrote me a check for $500 and had never met her before. So it was a great experience, but at some point we said, we can't keep doing this. We gotta start knocking on Republican doors. And that was hard. It was hard because it was a big shift in the message. But it was really important. And if you have a genuine conversation with someone and try to understand their issues, you know, we got a pretty big percentage of them. And after a while, I actually started saying, I don't want to knock Democrat doors. I only want Republicans, because it's the satisfaction of trying to have a genuine conversation and convert someone that, you know, I can represent their interests better than my opponent.
I would say, so my district, my race was a little bit different because it was citywide with 1.5 million people. There's no way that I could get to, or volunteers could get to, every single door. So a big part of the way, I mean, I went to all these community meetings, but also I needed to raise money, and raising money was necessary in order to get up on TV. And I was sort of skeptical about this idea of TV as a first-time candidate. I thought, you know, who watches TV? No one watches it anymore. But actually people do, because after I got up on TV, everyone said, I saw you on your commercial. So I said, well, you have to be watching TV then. But anyway, so spent a lot of time raising money. I had 75 fundraising house parties in a 3.5 month time period. I spent a lot of the time holed up making phone calls, raising money in order to be able to get on TV so people knew who I was on election day. And the other thing that my campaign did really well was save money for election day itself, to pay people to make sure people got out to vote. So to get people to say, come on, get out to vote. And I don't know how unique Philly is in this, but in Philadelphia, a get out to vote operation on election day itself is so important. And you got to pay the right people, not people that just take your money. So that's also important.
Yep, that's right. Now we've got we're just going to maybe come up with some closing statements here. What is the key takeaway, both in terms of what you and we as this group represent as four diverse women who come from different backgrounds, different parts of your state, and in my case, from the Commonwealth of Virginia, who bring a different worldview and a different experience to the table? What is the value of making sure that that worldview is represented, that that representation brings the power that people who are like us and people who are different from us desperately need us to have.
So for me, in Western Pennsylvania, I will be the first and only black woman to have ever been elected to state house from our area. We've never had one statewide elected to Congress. We've never had a woman elected to Senate. So that we are, and I am still coming up on first, is tremendous. And one of the things that we wanted to do through our races is we wanted to give people a reason to vote. People don't just turn out to vote when they have, you know, an election with two people or even one person on the ballot who they don't relate to, who doesn't sound like them or talk like them or care about them. It is so important that we have a diversity of perspective and experience. So it's not just that I'm black and not just that I'm a woman, but I've navigated this society different than other people. I bring those experiences with me, and I bring the experiences of my community with me wherever I go. And that's critically important, because when we talk about these issues, when we talk about education and environment and poverty and healthcare, these things impact us. Women's reproductive health, it impacts us. And we can't keep expecting people who don't relate to us to prioritize our needs. If we're not there, no one is gonna stand up for us and say, we should give them something. But when we're there, we can take it. So that's why it's so much more important that we start sending the system our representatives, not the other way around.
I agree with everything you said. I was elected as a township supervisor 5 years ago, and I was the only woman on the board. And sometimes I would go home ready to tear my hair out. But it also taught me a lot of patience and understanding that if I wanted to get anywhere, I had to learn how to deal with people who were different from me. And when I got elected in May in my special election, I became the first woman to ever hold the seat, first woman, person of color, and I'm the second Asian in the Pennsylvania House out of 203, which is kind of crazy. But I think, I don't have to repeat everything you said, but I think the other thing that's really, really wonderful is that my being elected has given so much hope and energy to my community and to people outside my community, but most importantly, in my community, I see people in the grocery store who I don't even know who will run up to me and say, I'm so glad you got elected. It's about time we got somebody different in there, you know, and they'll describe whatever characteristic is different, but they'll just, they're so happy. And to be able to give that to people, it makes me want to work really hard for them.
I agree with what those have said before me. I think, yeah, diversity of representation is so important because our communities have diversity in them. And in order to truly represent our communities, we need to have diverse voices in leadership. And I would just add to the conversation that don't let how you might think your diversity is a negative in whatever way that, or something different about you might create some sort of insecurity. What I would say to that is just, you know, blow it off and say, no, like, I'm gonna do this. I mean, so many people said to me, you know, a woman, you know, has never been controller, a woman's never won. I'm like, yeah, a woman's never, you know, been as qualified as me either, so stop it, you know? and so I think that is just so important to get that diversity so it's not all really homogeneous in terms of who's representing us.
All right, and so to close this out today, first off, please give a warm round of applause for all of our amazing, incredible women. This Commonwealth of Pennsylvania is incredibly blessed by your presence, and thank you for your public service. To close you out here, I want to give you a quick story, and then we'll get off the stage. In the special election in April of last year in Prince William County, our Democratic nominee, Jacqueline Smith, was outspent 7-1 in her clerk of the court race by the then House Republican Majority Whip. And at the same time, I went out into Haymarket, which is in the 13th district, which I now represent. I knocked on a door out there, and I was trying to get one person out from this one place in a one battleground precinct to come out to vote on that part of that turf. And so this woman in hijab, she answers the door, and I say, hi, my name's Dana Crum. I'm running for the House of Delegates, but I'm here to encourage you to vote this upcoming Tuesday for my friend Jacqueline Smith. Do you know about the election? No. Okay, well, let me tell you about what Jacqueline stands for, Belle. And I go through the particular issues of the courthouse, and then I close with, and that she believes that no matter what she looked like, where you come from, how you worship, or who you love, that you should be welcomed in our courthouse because of who you are, not despite it. Great. Do you think about to vote for Jacqueline on Tuesday? Yes? Awesome. Do you have any other registered voters in your home? Always remember that, dear volunteers. Do you have any other registered voters in your home? Actually, yes. So she brings out two college-age women. She brings out her mother. She brings out another woman who was registered. She just wanted to talk. That's cool. You know, I'm here. I'm an Italian extroverted woman, happily to do that. And so we talked, the college students were telling me about how the environment's important to them, climate change is important to them, college tuition's important to them, great. And the, but then I said to them, well, right, well, let me tell you about Jacqueline. So I go through the battery of the list. And I said, now I need you all to understand something. This is a battleground precinct where we are right now. My predecessor, who was at the time in office, as a Republican, won that precinct in every election since redistricting in 2011, 13, 15. And at the same time, Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine carried it in 2016. One household can flip this precinct in a low turnout special election like this. And if this one household can flip this precinct, then this precinct will flip Prince William County. And if we win Prince William County, Jacqueline Smith will win this race. Well, those four women got excited, those four women voted, and we won Tyler by 3 votes. And for the first time in a generation, we now have a Democratic clerk of the court in my friend Jacqueline Smith. Don't tell me that a quality conversation at the door can't replace $1 million with that. Don't tell me that someone is in office who's too entrenched or that this isn't yours to take. My friends, you are here today because you care. You are here to succeed because of who you are, not despite it, and not for what discriminatory politicians tell you you're supposed to be. You are here because you believe in something that is bigger than yourself, because you care about your community, you care about other people who are like you, and you have empathy for people who will never, ever understand what it means to be you, but you want them to succeed because they are also people, and you care about them. That's why you care about public service. We need more empathy in office. We need more compassion in office. And if you have that drive to run, bring it, because this is your America too, and it's time for you to run it. And again, no matter what you look like, where you come from, how you worship, if you do, or who you love, if you're well qualified, if you've got good ideas, bring them to the table. It's time for you to run, and it's time for you to win. Let's go win, America.
Preach! Preach on!
I'm talking about that.
My heart is full. How are you guys feeling?